Good morning and welcome to Scarborough Community Alliance Church. We are so glad that you can join us, and we all hope that you had a great Christmas day. This Sunday, may we continue to praise our God who poured out his love for us through his Son, Jesus Christ, by sending him down on earth to die on the cross for our sins, so that we may be free and have a relationship with him.
I cannot give an answer, but
Isaiah 25, verse 1 and 9 reads, Lord, you are my God. I will exalt you and praise your name. For in perfect faithfulness, you have done wonderful things, things planned long ago. In that day, they will say, surely this is our God. We trusted in him and he saved us. This is the Lord. We trusted in him. Let us rejoice and be glad in his salvation. We praise you and thank you for the love you have poured out for us, for this free gift you have given to all of us, for the Son, Jesus Christ, you had surrendered to die on the cross for all our sins so we may be blameless before you. May we not take this gift of grace for granted, but accept it in our hearts and allow your Spirit to transform our hearts to live a life that is glorifying to you as we follow you. Thank you for being our God who has power over death. So by faith we may accept your salvation, be free from death, and have an eternal life with you. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
Good morning. Now it's time for intercessory prayer. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you that we can worship you today in the virtual church. You have said in your words that it is not in a particular place that we can worship you, but that we should worship you in spirit and in truth. Though we are all at our different homes worshiping you and not in the same church building, we know that when we worship you genuinely and sincerely, our worship will be acceptable to you. So I pray today that as we worship today, that your name be glorified. We thank you for this Christmas season. We are reminded once again of your great love to us. The great I Am, the Alpha and Omega, creator of the whole universe, came to this world as a baby born in a manger. You made yourself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness and being found in appearance as a man, humbled yourself by becoming obedient to death, even death on a cross. This so that we can become your children and call you Abba Father. Thank you so much for your sacrifice on the cross. Today we pray for our church that it may be used by you for the furtherance of your kingdom. We pray that each and every member of this church will contribute to the making of disciples of all nations, fulfilling the great commission given to the church. We pray for Pastor Victor as he leads this church. Pray that you will give him wisdom that comes from above, so that the church will continue in the direction that you have planned. We pray for Pastor Amy, pray for healing of her medical illness, that she recover completely and thus be able to serve you once again. We pray for the elders' nomination process. We pray that the right elders be chosen to lead this church. Pray for the small group ministry that will be starting this year. Pray for all the leaders that they will be used by you to shepherd the flock in a small group that you're entrusted with. We also pray for the men's ministry that will start soon. We pray for the leaders, Justin, Jason, and Nick. Give them directions as to how to lead the group, so the men in the church will be encouraged to walk with you faithfully and serve you. We also pray for our children ministry. We pray that the leaders will have the capability to take up the task of continuing to minister to the children of our church, that we bring them to the saving knowledge of Jesus even at a young age. We pray for today's sermon that we will learn from it to love you and serve you more. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Now it's time for scripture reading. Let us read from Hebrews chapter 2, verse 1 to 4 and verse 10 to 18. Therefore, we must pay much closer attention to what we have heard, lest we drift away from it. For since the message declared by angels proved to be reliable, and every transgression or disobedience received a just retribution, how shall we escape it? How shall we escape if we neglect such a great salvation? It was declared at first by the Lord, and it was attested to us by those who heard, while God also bore witness by signs and wonders and various miracles and by gifts of the Holy Spirit, distributed according to his will. For it was fitting that he, for whom and by whom all things exist, in bringing many sons to glory, should make the founder of their salvation perfect through suffering. For he who sanctifies and those who are sanctified all have one source, that is, why he is not ashamed to call them brothers, saying, I will tell of your name to my brothers in the midst of the congregation. I will sing your praise. And again, I will put my trust in him. And again, behold, I and the children of God has given me. Since therefore the children share in flesh and blood, he himself likewise partook of the same things, that through death he might destroy the one who has the power of death, that is, the devil, and deliver all those who through fear of death were subject to lifelong slavery. For surely it is not angels that he helps, but he helps the offspring of Abraham. Therefore, he had to be made like his brothers in every respect, so that he might become a merciful and faithful high priest in the service of God, to make propitiation for the sins of the people. For because he himself has suffered when tempted, he is able to help those who are being tempted. May God bless the reading of his words.
Well, good morning, everyone, and welcome to our New Year's Eve Sunday service. This is the last Sunday of 2020, and I hope that you were able to enjoy your Christmas Day celebrations, even though it may have been only within your own household. And I hope that you were able to watch our SCOM Christmas Day presentation, and that if you did see it, may it have been a blessing to you, to all of us. And I want to thank the worship teams and the helpers and all of the IT people who helped set it up and put it together. We praise God for that. Well, last week I picked up my daughter from her work in the evening, and on our way home in the car, I had quite a harrowing experience. So I'm driving westbound on McNichol, heading towards my home, and I'm just past McCowan, and then there's this white panel. I'm in the right-hand lane, and there's this white panel van heading westbound, just like me, but the white van is in the left-hand lane. I'm in the right-hand lane. And it's very interesting because this big white panel van was straddling the center line. I mean, sometimes it was drifting into my lane by a foot and a half, sometimes two, and then it would go back into its proper lane to be sure. But the van just could not stay in his own lane next to me. So I dare not pass that van on the right-hand side. There's no way. I even slowed down a number of times because I'm not getting anywhere near this bad driver. I don't know if he or she had a few drinks or whatever the case might be, but anyways, at the very next major intersection, I turned right to get clear out of there to avoid that lousy driver. Well, it's hard to imagine in any context where drifting might be considered a good thing. I mean, think about it. A car, a truck drifts from its lane into another lane. A boat begins to drift off course. A plane begins to drift off of its landing strip target line. I mean, when the plane drifts off too far, it's going to be a boom and a bang for sure. There's no doubt about it. That's the result. So I think that as we come to the end of the year, let's recognize that when we neglect spiritual matters, it can result in spiritual drifting. The consequences of spiritual drifting can truly be dangerous, and it can be a boom and a bang for us in our lives. I mean, it seems to me that God's word provides us with the boundaries of our pathway. It provides us with the guardrail on the road that we are traveling. And when we drift away from the truth of God, when that happens in our lives, we end up allowing the winds of our cultural climate, of our North American culture, we allow that to direct our sails and to point us in a direction we may not always necessarily want to go down. And in the end, what will happen is that we will, in most likelihood, be captured by the darkness. Now, I don't know about you, but if we just take a glance around North America and we look at the churches in today's world, I mean, there are many downward trends that are, or should be, of great concern to all of us who are Christians, because what we often see in many other churches is doctrinal deviation. We see moral compromise. We see rampant adultery. We see cultural conformity. We see many churches that are really, really concerned about profit, margin, bottom line, materialism, and the list goes on and on and on. And actually, I don't think there's any guarantee that SCOM will never go down this kind of a path. Because if we're to be honest with ourselves, there are a lot of snares in this world today. And I think any one of us, or maybe even all of us, can be captured at any one time. And so it's vital and crucial for all of us to pay heed to the Word of God. So, I mean, as we come to the end of 2020, I'm hoping that today's message isn't too heavy. Sometimes it is, and I recognize that. But I hope that today's message will be very encouraging and very freeing for all of us who are here this morning together. So let's turn to our passage now. And we are looking at Hebrews chapter 2. And the writer of Hebrews, if you did not know, he wants all who claim to be a follower of Jesus Christ to be fully alive, to be fully free in the world in which we live. The writer is going to tell us, don't crash your boat. Don't drive into a ditch. Don't miss your landing point. And ultimately, Hebrews chapter 2 and the entire book of Hebrews will teach us this one main principle, especially from chapter 2, that freedom to be fully alive requires a connection to the founder of our salvation. Freedom to be fully alive requires a connection to the author of salvation. So here in chapter 2, in the verses 1 to 4, really, we come to the first main point of the message this morning. And it is number one, the danger of drifting. Take a look with me at verses 1 to 4. The danger of drifting. Therefore, we must pay closer attention to what we have heard, lest we drift away from it. For since the message declared by the angels provided to be proved to be reliable, and every transgression or disobedience received a just retribution, how shall we escape if we neglect such a great salvation? It was declared at first by the Lord, and it was attested to us by those who heard, while God also bore witness by signs and wonders and various miracles and by gifts of the Holy Spirit distributed according to His will. What a beautiful passage. Now the people to whom the book of Hebrews was written to, I mean, they were Jews who were recently converted from Judaism to Jesus Christ and to be converts of Jesus Christ. And life for those Jews who left Judaism to follow Jesus, I mean, life was really grim for them. It was very, very difficult. And many of these converts were starting to have second thoughts. Is it worth it? Why did I leave the old faith? And so they were thinking, should I go back to Judaism? Should I go back to the old way of life? Should I go back to the old friends in the synagogue and to the Old Testament? And so the focus of the author here was to convince the readers that Jesus Christ is deserving of their complete and continued allegiance. Why? Why? Because Jesus Christ is superior to everything they have ever known and everything that they have ever believed, everything that they have ever read in the Old Testament. In fact, the author of Hebrews is going to declare that Jesus Christ is the total fulfillment of everything that Judaism has ever believed. And so the author inserts what is called warning passages in many sections throughout the book of Hebrews. I mean, here in chapter 2, verses 1 to 4, he says what? Pay attention lest you drift. In chapter 3, verse 15, he says, beware of a hardened heart. In chapter 5, verse 11, he says, don't be hard of hearing to the word of God. In chapter 10, verse 39, he says, don't shrink back to the old way of belief. And in chapter 12, verse 25, he says, do not refuse him, the author of our faith. So in chapter 1, in the chapter just before our chapter, I mean, the author wrote in a way that was all about how God has spoken his final word through his one and only Son, Jesus Christ. And through the words of Jesus Christ, this was God's ultimate message to all of humanity. And not surprisingly, Jesus Christ is greater than everyone and everything the Jews have ever known or seen or experienced, period. No one deserves it, the salvation that God gives to us through Jesus Christ. No one can earn it. No one can work for it. But out of God's abundance of grace, out of God's endless compassion, he offers salvation to all peoples, even though we don't deserve it. So as we come to our text in chapter 2, the writer basically says in verses 1 to 4, now having inherited such a great salvation from God, which was given to us freely as a gift, he's teaching that followers of Jesus must take care that they don't despise something that they didn't even deserve or did not ever earn. And so the author of Hebrews really is pleading once again. Take a look here at verses 1 to 3 because it is so worth repeating in verses 1 to 3. He writes this, therefore, we must pay much closer attention to what we have heard, lest we drift away from it. For since the message declared by the angels provided proved to be reliable, and every transgression or disobedience received a just retribution, how shall we escape if we neglect such a great and free salvation? You know, it's really hard for me to believe that less than 1 year ago that my family and one of our daughters, we had traveled to Vietnam for 2 weeks. And we had flown there and came back just before the world pandemic shutdown came upon this earth. And yes, we went and we returned from that COVID pandemic shutdown in March. We returned in February, near the end of February. Now, for those of you who know me and know me well, you will know that I do not like to fly in airplanes. I have a slight phobia about flying. I rarely buy tickets to go on any flight, probably less than 8 or 9 times in my entire life I've been on a plane. And you know, when the flight attendant begins that instructional speech that they go through, where they stand in the center aisle and they're telling everybody about, what to do in the case of emergency. In today's world, I know it's just a taped recording and that the attendants simply act out, you know, all these things about what to do in emergency. I actually think I was the only one on board of that plane that actually listened to every word the attendants had said on the recording and demonstrated about what to do in an emergency. Now, by the time we went to Vietnam, and we actually had probably about 6 flights by the time we came back to Toronto, counting them all. And I can tell you that by the time we came back to Toronto on the last flight, we came back, I mean, when those attendants started talking, the recording went on, I was already snoring away. Like, I couldn't care less about the words that they were saying, the instructions that they were giving in the case of an emergency. I mean, those instructions already, 2 weeks later, had gotten very, very old, very, very fast. And I freely admit, I couldn't care less about what these attendants were saying. It just got really, really old. Now, I don't know about you, but some of us may have, over the course of time, whether it's a long time or a short time, we may have developed a careless attitude to the Word of God. We may have this ho-hum attitude whenever we hear the Word of God, and we may barely even open the Word of God to read anymore because We've just developed this careless, ho-hum attitude about God's word as Christians. It's true. Now, I don't know about you, but I do know that some converts in the book of Hebrews started second-guessing the word of God. They started having this careless attitude and this disconnect from the word of God. They became ho-hum, even in the beginning stages of their newfound faith in Jesus Christ. And they were moving in a direction that was going back to the old way of life. It's unbelievable. Converting to Jesus Christ and then thinking about going back to the old way of life. Well, ultimately what we're learning in verses 1 to 4 is that's what can happen when we drift off course from obeying the word of God. And so if we're to be honest with ourselves today, I mean, let's think about ourselves. Has that been happening to any of us, that we've disconnected from the word of God? We've developed a careless attitude towards the word of God? Are any of us kind of ho-hum, it's just the word of God, oh, it's just another sermon, oh, it's just another discipleship class, oh, it's just another devotional? Because the author here warns us about the dangers of drifting away from the word. And so we need to pay attention and pay heed to it. That's the first point here in our text. The author now leads us to a second point. And the second point is really taken from verses 10 to 18. And this second point is simply the defeat of fear and death. Not only do we hear about the dangers of drifting, but we now learn about the defeat of fear and death. Look with me at verses 10 to 18. For it was fitting that he, for whom and by whom all things exist, in bringing many sons to glory, should make the founder of their salvation perfect through suffering. For he who sanctifies and those who are sanctified all have one source. That is why he is not ashamed to call them brothers, saying, I will tell of your name to my brothers. In the midst of the congregation, I will sing your praise. And again, I will put my trust in him. And again, behold, I and the children of God has given me. Since therefore the children share in flesh and blood, he himself likewise partook of the same things, that through death he might destroy the one who has the power of death, that is the devil, and deliver them or free them, all those who through fear of death were subject to lifelong slavery. For surely it is not angels that he helps, but he helps the offspring of Abraham. Therefore he had to be made like his brothers in every respect, so that he might become a merciful and faithful high priest in the service of God, to make propitiation for the sins of the people. For because he himself has suffered when tempted, he is able to help all those who are also being tempted. Here in this passage, in this section, it's incredible, because the author, what he does is like he pulls back the curtain of another world. He pulls back the curtain so that we in the physical world can get a glimpse into the spiritual world. And in chapter 2, let's notice in verse 10 that the author declares Jesus Christ to be the founder of salvation. He declares that Jesus Christ is perfect. He's been made perfect through his suffering and sacrifice on the cross. And that all Christians have one and only one author of salvation. And that is unequivocally Jesus Christ, who he calls his followers. He calls all Christians brothers or sisters. Jesus Christ, who is God, stepped out of heaven And why did he do that? Why did he leave the perfections of heaven, the perfections of his throne, and come into this earth? Well, I mean, just like last week, I explained that it is again re-emphasized here in verses 14 to 15. Take a look with me again. Verse 14. Since therefore the children share in flesh and blood, he himself likewise partook of the same things, and through death he, Jesus Christ, might destroy the one who has the power of death, that is the devil, and that he might deliver and free all those who through fear of death were subjected to lifelong slavery. And so here it's clear that Jesus himself partook of the same flesh and blood that we all have, and by suffering and by dying and by being resurrected from the dead, he struck a death blow to the devil. To the devil, he did. And for all who convert to Jesus Christ as the one who has ultimate dominion over heaven and earth, I mean, he has ultimate dominion in the physical world, and he has ultimate dominion in the spiritual world. For all who convert to Jesus Christ, we are and can be freed from the fear of death and the power of death and darkness. And we can be delivered from being subjected and held in bondage to the things of sin, evil, and darkness. We don't have to be enslaved to evil any longer when we are children of God. And even though we might be reminded of, I mean, we're reminded every day that we are mortals on this earth, aren't we? Even though we might be reminded every day that we are mortals, I mean, I wake up with a sore back sometimes. I certainly don't have the memory that I used to have when I was younger. I certainly don't have the strength, the speed, nor the flexibility, as my wife keeps reminding me, that I used to have when I was younger. But I tell you, I'm still young at heart, but my physical body every day is a reminder that I am still mortal for now. You see, I'm talking about myself here because this body is aging. I am aging. It's a fact of life. It's the normal process of a human being, and so be it. But I'm not alone. I have ailments. Many of us have ailments and diseases and memory lapses, and they just remind us every day that we are mere mortals. And yet, there is the superiority of Jesus Christ over sin and over Satan and over suffering. And so when we embrace Jesus Christ, we are given hope, friends. We have hope and confidence to press on for Jesus Christ when we know of his ultimate defeat over sin and death and Satan and evil and darkness. And once we join in with the author and the founder of salvation, Jesus Christ, it's now possible, very possible, for us to be free and to become whom God has always designed us to become. And when we acknowledge that we can become free and alive and to achieve all that God has always designed us to be, I mean, this brings us to the third point this morning of this New Year's Eve message. And the third point is simply this. We now see, number three, the design of God. The design of God for us to be fully alive, to be fully free from sin and darkness and bondage, and to be fully able to live for the glory of God. Again, take a look at verses 14 to 15, because they give us the instruction here. Verse 14, since therefore the children share in flesh and blood, he himself likewise partook of the same things, but through death he, Jesus Christ, might destroy the one who has the power or the keys of death, that is the devil, and that he, Jesus Christ, might deliver and free all those who through fear of death were subject to lifelong slavery. Wow, freedom to be fully alive. Freedom to be fully alive. Freedom to become how God has always designed and planned for humans to become. I want to invite you to turn with me to one of the greatest passages in the New Testament about freedom. And I want you to turn with me to Galatians chapter 5. And I'd like to be able to read verses 16 to 25 together here. And let's recognize that Paul in Galatians chapter 5, I mean in verse 1, he starts off by saying, "For freedom, Christ has set us free." It's all about freedom. And then in verse 13, Paul writes, "For you were called to freedom, brothers. Don't use your freedom as an opportunity for the flesh, but through love, serve one another." It's a beautiful passage of freedom, being fully alive and free to become all that God has designed us to become. So let's read together in verses 16 to 25. And if you want to read out loud where you are, do that. Join with me, connect with me. Here we are in verse 16. "But I say, walk by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the flesh. For the desires of the flesh are against the Spirit, and the desires of the Spirit are against the flesh. For these are opposed to each other, to keep you from doing the things you want to do. But if you are led by the Spirit, you are not under the law. Now the works of the flesh are evident: sexual immorality, impurity, sensuality, idolatry, sorcery, enmity, strife, jealousy, fits of anger, rivalries, dissensions, divisions, envy, drunkenness, orgies, and things like these. I warn you, as I warned you before, that those who do such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such things there is no law. And those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. If we live by the Spirit, let us keep in step with the Spirit." Wow. Friends, God has designed all of us human beings to live in perfect union with God. But not only has He designed us to live in perfect union with God, God has always designed us humans to live in perfect union with one another, to love one another, to serve one another. It's beautiful what God has designed us to become. And yet we look at ourselves and we look at this world. Why the hate? Why the crime? Why the desire to do bad and to do harm? Why the destruction or the dissension or the jealousy or the pride? Why the addictions? Why the judgmentalism? It's because we are born with a broken and sinful nature that we have inherited. And there's only one solution. The solution is clear in the book of Hebrews and the entire New Testament, fulfilling the entire Old Testament. It's Jesus Christ and accepting Him. It's being willing and committed to following Jesus Christ in a personal, vibrant, everyday relationship in which we are filled by more of God's Word, and we are in a deep, dynamic relationship with God through Jesus Christ. You see, Jesus Christ is the only one who can provide us with hope. But He doesn't just give us hope, He gives us help. He gives us the Holy Spirit to indwell in us, to reside in us, to be in us. You see, the Holy Spirit is indwelling in every true Christian to be able to have the power to live a victorious life over death. We no longer need to fear death. We no longer need to turn to darkness. We no longer need to turn to sin. We can say no to sin and darkness and evil. And we'll be able to do that as we live on this earth and as we go into eternity in heaven. And so, friends, it's such a celebration when we think about the words of Scripture. And as we stand on the doorway of 2021, as we stand on the porch of entering the new year, how will your life be different in the new year than from this year, 2020? Will you stop drifting away from the Word of God and devote yourself to engaging regularly in devotions and in the reading of the Word of God? I mean, come on, let us stop seeking something new. We're always looking for something new, some spiritual insight. No, no, no. Let us start devouring and acting on what we have already known from Scripture. Let us start absorbing what we hear on sermons and Sunday schools, discipleship classes, devotions. Let us start acting on what we've already heard from Scripture. And let us never become lackadaisical and have a ho-hum, careless attitude towards the Word of God. Now, I'll be a little bit transparent with you this morning. Please don't laugh, but it's okay if you do. I just recently bought this book, Daily Devotions for Men. Got it at a really good price. There are 365 devotions in here. I'm starting on January 1st, and on top of the regular devotional material I regularly do, I want to have one extra devotional time every day with God for 365 days in this year. I don't know how I'm going to do, but I'll probably likely give you an update every once in a while later on, because I really want to and I need to stop drifting away from the Word of God. Another question that we should challenge ourselves with this morning is, do you have any sinful habits that you are aware of in your life? Do you? Do you have any habitual sins? Of course you do. Of course I do. We all do. The question is, have you told anybody? And the answer is probably, of course not. Why would we tell anyone our secret habitual sins? Well, I'm going to suggest this morning that we need to tell somebody. We haven't been able to conquer our hidden sins by ourselves. And what we need more than anything is a personal confidant who we can truly trust, and to say to our confidant, listen, I need you to pray for me because I'm having this struggle in the past little while. And don't be surprised if the confidant says to you, oh, you too? Oh, you too? The things that we are struggling and addicted and habitually committing, we're not the only ones in this world. God knows that. You should know that. I know that. We know that. But what a beautiful thing it is to have a private, personal confidant that we can ask for prayer and support, not judgmentalism, not criticism, not a lecture about how we should change. No. It's about praying for one another, supporting one another. Whether it's in a personal confidant, a spouse, a mentor-mentee relationship, whatever it is, we need it if we are to be serious about overcoming our habitual sins. And so we need to start thinking about enlisting in the help of caring brothers and sisters who can hold a confidence. Maybe the last thing I could mention this morning is, I mean, we've read Galatians 5. We read the fruit of the Spirit. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Out of these 9 fruit of the Spirit, what do you lack the most? What do I lack the most? What do we lack the most? All of them? Well, maybe. Maybe that might be true for some people here. But when we think about real spiritual fruit, we have studied this in small groups, spiritual fruit, the fruit of the Spirit. And the conclusion that we have come to is that real spiritual fruit can only exist as a byproduct of a right relationship with Jesus Christ. You can't manufacture this kind of fruit, true spiritual fruit, from human effort alone. And so we all need more of God's word to be implanted, deeply implanted in our souls through a living, dynamic relationship with Jesus Christ. And when we do that and cultivate that personal relationship, the Spirit brings out the love, joy, peace, and all of the fruit of the Spirit. My friends, we learned today that God is a God of total freedom. And it's His desire that we be fully alive and fully free from sin, darkness, and evil, so that we might become recreated and rebuilt in the image of God. And my prayer for you and us and myself for 2021 is that we might all become a reflection of Jesus Christ and His character. Let's close in prayer. Our dear Heavenly Father, we thank You for this beautiful reminder today from the book of Hebrews to be careful not to drift, to know that Jesus Christ secured a victory over the fear of death and darkness, and that we can be free, free to be able to be fully alive and to achieve what You have always designed us to be children of God, reflecting the perfections of holiness. Not that we can achieve that on our own strength, but by Your grace, by Your power, by Your Spirit, by Your word, may that become ever more true in 2021. And all of God's people say, amen, amen.
Thank you, Pastor Victor, for your message. As we sing Egypt as our response song, may we be reminded that our God is a God who fights for us and who stepped into our darkness, took us by the hand, and marched us out into freedom.
You found you.
Thank you, Joelle and Adrian, for leading us in that song, Egypt. I love that concept. And if you didn't know, I'll be preaching on the Exodus and Moses in the second half of 2021. Just one announcement before we close off today. Just want to remind you that we have a New Year's Eve presentation from our church. It's going to take place Thursday, December the 31st on New Year's Eve. And it's going to be released for 8 o'clock in the evening, 8 p.m. It's going to be very lighthearted. It's going to be very celebrative. There will be a game involved. There will be testimonies involved. And the whole presentation will focus on God's goodness and His sustaining strength that all of us have access to. Those are all the announcements for now. Let's bow our heads, close in prayer, and receive the benediction. Our dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for being the God who does set us free. We have that ability to accept Jesus Christ, and how can we ever thank you enough? May you help us to be more like you in 2021. And now may our Lord Jesus Christ Himself and God, our Heavenly Father, who loved us and by His grace gave eternal encouragement and good hope, encourage your hearts and strengthen you in every good deed and word. And may we become more like Jesus in 2020. And all of God's people say together, amen, amen. Have a great week, and we'll look forward to entering the new year together by the grace of God. Thank you. May God bless you all.